Let's give this a shot. Let's see what happens. Hello, my friends and relations. Another Tomcast in the works for you right now. It is Sunday, the 29th of August. We've had a very brutal, emotional week if you're a fan of any veterans in your life. The war in Afghanistan has gone terribly bad and sad, but it might be coming to an end hopefully soon. Rest in peace, those Marines who tragically lost their lives. But what I wanted to talk about today is the future. In order to talk about the future, I have to talk about the past a little bit. What I want to talk about is inspiration. Inspiration for making something better. I had a great conversation with a neighbor of mine named Lloyd about how when he grew up in the 50s and 60s, he remembered science fiction being very optimistic. He was a child when the first Star Trek show came on in 1967. And at the time, it had this idyllic view of the future, where you had a diverse, multicultural, multi-ethnic crew working together on a spaceship. Today, that's common. In fact, we see it in our contemporary life. The astronauts that go to the International Space Station are of multicultural, multinational, and multi-ethnic backgrounds. And that's good. But the vision for that might be owed to the creators of Star Trek back in the 60s or even earlier, to people, great minds, great thinkers. So I think a lot of the vision for what the future that is given to us by artists and creative and free thinkers collaborating can help other people be inspired to make something better. Lloyd said that he was disheartened by the kinds of sci-fi that he saw in the 80s. As beautiful as they were, the quality of production level was getting better and better and better as Hollywood got better at making movies. But the themes and topics in the 80s got a little bit more depressing, more dystopic, more run down. Think about Blade Runner. Think about Aliens. Think about some of the parts of Star Wars. Empire Strikes Back is amazing, but it has a very depressing theme. That movie is about loss, and eventually there's going to be the triumph at the end of the trilogy. But some of these movies that were coming out in the 80s were kind of depressing. I think I was raised with internal optimism, but being surrounded by images of dystopia and apocalyptic futures from other kinds of movies. Let's talk about some of the movies that inspired me growing up and some of the artwork that inspired me growing up. And hopefully we'll get to a conclusion where I think it's really the job of artists and creatives these days now to come up with a brighter vision of the future. Look, we've gotten through most of the pandemic. We've gotten through most of the wars. Hopefully things are going to get better, but I think artists, creative architects, everywhere, people could spend a little bit more time thinking about optimism and what's good about the future ahead, giving people a vision of what good can happen. So let's start with some of the videos. So movies that I think about that inspired me growing up from the youngest might have been some of the Disney pictures. So I'm going to drag over some YouTube, and hopefully no one gets too mad at me for doing this. So when I was a little kid, I watched old Disney movies. This is a clip from Disney's Man in Space, which you can get on Disney Plus right now. I highly recommend watching it. It's kind of fascinating about what the 1950s Disney artists thought the future was going to look like. This movie was made long before we had launched a man into space. I think this was like 1955 this was made. And this was 15 years before we put a man on the moon, contextually. So they had ideas of what that would look like. Concept art is essential for getting a team of engineers and money people and producers and patrons all on the same page for what we're making. So somewhere there had to be an artist who took a bunch of these abstract verbal ideas and put those ideas and translated them to paper to show a whole room full of people, hey, is this what you are all thinking? And then that'll lead to conversation. Yes, no, maybe. Maybe those wings are too big. Maybe this fuselage is too long. The rocket wouldn't really look like that. Let's change things so we could all get on the same page. I saw these animated movies of what science fiction, of what scientists thought the future was going to look like. So Disney was probably my first inspiration when I was a little kid. I remember my dad loving Star Wars and Aliens. So, I mean, I think Star Wars is probably the number two. I probably watched that next, probably when I was like 6, 7 years old, watching Star Wars on television. My dad recorded it, put it on a VHS tape. I burned that VHS tape out watching these movies over and over and over again. And who didn't? Right? Star Wars was amazing. Everyone's seen Star Wars. Enough of that. Close You, Luke Skywalker, Mark Hamill. Aliens, my buddy Steve and I's favorite movie. The James Cameron putting his mark on the vision that Ridley Scott had of this dystopic future where corporations are running space travel. They have their own private military force. Cameron talked about this being his homage to the Vietnam War movie, about the idea of maybe American or Western elitism going into the jungle and then getting their ass handed to them by the local indigenous. And in this case, the indigenous are these xenomorph aliens that are brutal, that lay eggs inside of people. This high thriller combat movie with space marines wearing armor and equipped with really cool weapons. I just thought that was really, really neat and inspirational while I was a kid. I think a lot of people got jazzed about the firefights and Corporal Hicks and Hudson and all these characters and the really sweet battles that the Marines had with the aliens and how Ripley heroically saves Newt and gets into a power armor suit at the end and then fights off the big queen alien at the end of the movie. Pretty, pretty sweet. But who are the artists? Like, this motion picture, all these motion pictures are really well-defined. Where did the vision for these films come from? Ridley Scott, James Cameron, they were artists, and they worked with other artists to come up with what the look of the future might have been. I think the most famous of these futurists, or conceptual futurists, would be Sid Mead. Now, this is a famous painting that he did as a concept for Blade Runner, what the spinner, the car, the flying car that Deckard, played by Harrison Ford, flew. This was his painting of that. I believe he used acrylic, maybe gouache at the time. Sid Mead, very famous visual futurist. Not to be confused with the 1930s futurists from Italy. That's a different movement. Like Duchamp did some futurism. Classical art futurism of the art world was about making paintings of objects in motion. But when I'm talking about, for the purposes of this talk, and usually when I lecture about art, when I talk about futurism, it's mostly about concept artists from the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and today who are predicting what the future will look like in art form. Sid Mead, one of the first and most popular. Next might be Ron Cobb. I have a Ron Cobb painting somewhere, who worked with Sid Mead on movies like Aliens and E.T. and a few other stories like that. So Ron Cobb, known for his napkin sketches, brainstorming, he had a very good understanding of mechanical shapes and objects. I think this is a concept he did for The Last Starfighter. For other movies, Robot Jocks. This was the Sulaco cockpit for Alien. What's up, Luke? Luke chimed in. Luke says, you just wore out the slave Leia portions of VHS. That's right. That's what I wore out. 100%. So Ron Cobb, part of the collaboration process with Sid Mead, working on some of the big 1980s blockbuster sci-fi movies. Sometimes he would do a big sketch that would give a little bit more resolution. I think this was a concept for Alien or Aliens as well. One of those two. Now, those guys operated in the 70s and 80s. Now, who's more contemporary? If we fast forward to recently, maybe you get Justin Sweet, who I got to meet when I was in art school at MICA in the 2000s, from 2001 to 2005. I was down in Baltimore. Well, I technically graduated in 2004, but my graduation year would have been 2005. I finished up a little bit early because of my internships. Justin Sweet, known for work on some of the Lord of the Rings stuff, some Game of Thrones stuff, a really talented painter, some Star Wars stuff. Highly recommend checking out Justin's Guardians of the Galaxy, a painting of Drax, brainstorming for that. Justin's a little bit darker, definitely some Star Wars work here. another contemporary artist. I think it's Brian Matias. I'm not really sure. Matias? Not really sure, but he did a bunch of work for Guardians, for Batman, Mandalorian. These Mandalorian paintings really turned me on when I saw them. I love the Mandalorian TV show, but like this painting, it's got a really good pose, it's got really good proportions, it's got a nice used universe type feel, but also it's iconic. Very clear lines and shapes, exaggerated pose, 1970s color aesthetic. Like the faded color designs of costumes that would have been saturated at one point but then faded down by 50% is a iconic look in the Star Wars universe, and this artist just nailed it. Sorry, Brian, I don't know how to say your name correctly, but I do love your work. Not that you're ever going to see this, but thought I'd give it a shout out. This is mostly, this lecture is more for students and for reference down in the years to come. Let's rewind. Let's go back real old school. Who's a concept artist or an illustrator from way back in the day that's inspired people? N.C. Wyeth. N.C. Wyeth was a painter that we looked at when I was working at Firaxis in 2003 as an intern for Sid Meier's Pirates. His paintings and illustrations of Treasure Island, exaggerated pose, bright colors. It's a Disney-esque world, but this is 40 years before Disney. So this kind of image is, I think, what inspired someone like Disney to do colorful animated stories about the Wild West or pirates and Indians or the fantasy land. N.C. Wyeth, absolutely outstanding illustrator, was the grandfather of contemporary Wyeths who are still somewhat famous. There's other Wyeths, two generations of famous painters in that family too. Take that and then fast forward to the 2000s and then Craig Mullins. Craig Mullins is a digital painter now, but was a traditional oil painter. I think he went to Art Center or Cal Art, one of those two places, learned traditional oil painting and became a concept artist for film and video games in the 2000s. Craig Mullins, a huge inspiration for me and my compatriot digital illustrators coming out of art school in the 2000s. Goodbrush.com. Craig Mullins, this image takes me right back to art school looking at this. It might be sloppy compared to today's concept art that you might see on ArtStation, but if it wasn't for Craig Mullins taking the methods of painting from fine art and bringing it into the digital with Photoshop, with Wacom tablets, who knows where we would be today. I think he accelerated the pace of art coming to the digital computer and doing work. One of the reasons for doing this lecture today is last night my buddy Steve came up and we watched Dune. I'm really excited about the new movie Dune, but I wanted to understand the old or the original. Now, I haven't read the book. I've heard the book is outstanding, but it's the idea of a giant space opera that spans an entire universe thousands of years in the future. Some of the artwork is campy and feels like way out of scale for today's audience. It's just the production value was limited to what they could do in 1980. I think David Lynch did an outstanding job trying to get the scale of this universe. It's just immensely huge. I think it's going to be very interesting to see if the new Villanueva movie captures the scale of what the book was trying to do. There's a great documentary called Jodorowsky's Dune about the process of trying to create Dune before Star Wars came out. And there's a lot of evidence to say that Star Wars was based on Dune. That, you know, maybe it was even, it's possible Lucas even came out and said that he was inspired by the book, Frank Herbert's Dune. But you definitely get inspiration for Tatooine, for a lot of the spaceships, for the scale, for some of the hero's journey type stuff. Even though the Dune movie wasn't put in theaters until the 80s, which is later than 1977 Star Wars by George Lucas, it's got a lot of the same tropes and themes and in story points. It's definitely harder to follow, though, than Star Wars. Star Wars is approachable and near universally understood. That's the real genius of Star Wars. It's not that any one particular thing is original. It's that Lucas combined as many universal hero's journey stories into something very relatable, and his art department made something that was relatable as well. So hopefully that gives you a little bit of sense of the inspiration that I came from when I wanted to make art in the world. And then here is a process for creating a sci-fi character for a game I worked on about 6 years ago called Star Control Origins. Came out about in 2018 or 2019. I didn't finish it. I ended up leaving Stardock before I was done. But I was the interim art director for a minute and collaborated with some very talented artists to come up with some of the space characters. One of the favorite characters is called the Taiwan. He's this goofy, friendly alien who isn't aggressive at all, but who is kind of a watcher who wants to be friends with the humans. And this concept was a big back and forth between our writer, Ryan Murray, and myself. And I think Matt Houston took a couple passes on it. Matt Houston, who ended up being the full-time concept artist for that project. That is Matt Houston, H-U-E-S-T-O-N, or H-E-U-S-T-O-N. He now works for Oxide. Great guy. And this is the final stage that I took the concepts for the character and the ship. And we wanted them to be relatable so they have the same kind of color. Even though it'd be very silly if human beings had, like, skin color vehicles we drove around in. Like, that'd be very strange, but for the player who wasn't used to this alien civilization, I thought it would be handy that they're the same color. This kind of gold, happy, shiny, relatable color that would be immediately friendly and like. Now, how did we get here? Let me see if I can go through the process. I found some old concept art sheets, and hopefully they'll help us, take us through the process to ending up on a concept and end up getting modeled for a game. First, when I was interim art director, we talked a lot about what style did we want. So it's common to put together a palette of inspiration. Now, this looks like a mess, but I'll take you through it. If it was a graph left to right, the left side would be like comic book and maximum cartoony, and then towards the middle is caricature, and then on the far right would be realism. So full realism on the right, exaggerated or romantic realism just inside of that. And so what we're seeing is, so let's start with the real. Far right, you have Yuri Gagarin. You've got astronauts from the real world, Apollo landings, the ISS, Russian, Soviet-built machines, and minerals and gems and things. And then we get on the inside, we get television shows like Star Trek, The Rocketeer, concept art from early... it was Norman Rockwell painting of what the moon landing looked like. So Norman Rockwell takes a photograph and cleans it up and paints it up and does his interpretation of what the photograph could say to give a little bit more detail to the average audience of the 1970s. Del Toro concept for Hellboy, some video game kind of concept art, some really wild sea creatures and stuff, aliens. I love Berkeley. I think it's Berkeley. Is it Berkeley or Berkey artist? I think his name is Berkey, painter from the 60s through the 80s. I love his paintings. Very painterly. A lot of these white spaceships with a lot of different colors, warms and cools. Concept art. So we're getting towards the middle. I would say like Team Fortress Classic and Borderlands are somewhere in this middle between cartoony and realism. Maybe some Fifth Element inspired art. Mobius was the illustrator for that. Moby Franck is the artist that came up with the style for Team Fort. Some of the stuff from Homeworld's really good. And then far cartoony would be like a Ratchet and Clank. I guess Borderlands pretty cartoony. Star Fox, absolutely. A lot of Zelda, Disney type stuff. Jake, what's his name? He's a really good concept artist. Who I think he does the Inktober stuff. I'll think of it. I feel real bad. He has a name that's like two first names. It's not Jake Paul. Earthworm Jim, very cartoony. Love Earthworm Jim growing up. So wild. It was that 90s MTV aesthetic. Gonzo, Ren and Stimpy, South Park, that type of stuff. All right. So do a map or a legend of styles and then kind of pick where do we want to be stylistically. Rendering something completely realistic is very expensive on the modeling side and on the rendering side, but you can take real world objects and import them in. It's just the simulation is very expensive. Cartoony is much simpler on the rendering costs, but it takes more time to come up with the idea, come up with the abstraction, to develop the simplicity. Simplicity is hard. The real world is very complicated. Abstracting the real world into something that's universal and understandable is actually a lot of effort to do. All right, so that's where we kind of started with in terms of deciding style. Let's close this. And then let's work through some brainstorming. I think I started with the ship, because most of the game you'd be seeing the ship, not the character. So I might do a week's worth of drawings, just go riffing off the yellow theme, trying to come up with a light source from the upper left corner, and then cool rim lights on the backside to give us this 3D shape. I'll give us a slow pan through brainstorming ship shapes. I think the designer wanted the weapon system was going to be these three drones, these three spherical drones that would be fired off and either could defend the player ship or go out and hunt down the enemy ship. So having some constraints from game design is important for coming up with a visual design of the ship. These were kind of fun. Looks a little like marble. Snow globe with some equipment on the outside of the snow globe and little pods coming off of it. Like maybe these aliens live in a little fish tank and control it from inside of a fish tank. That might be fun. Inspiration can really come from anywhere. Let's go through the layers on this because there's a lot to unpack here. So this page started some character brainstorming, thinking this friendly, goopy, alien, weak-bodied creature that isn't too imposing. Something like puppy dog-looking guy. This ended up sticking. The idea of, like, the character being very self-conscious, so always touching, like, keeping its hands inside, and then the keyboards being the natural spot to put its hands, like having a fidget device that this insecure alien could be fiddling with. Some ideas we talked about. Maybe this is a regal king of the Taiwan idea. More ideas. When I run out of ideas for drawing the character, maybe I'll bounce back to the spaceship idea. This looks this cute dude. He's kind of cool. It's kind of fun. So here's some more spaceship ideas. What if we went with white with the gold trim? Still working on the idea of threes. These are some later paintings when we got pretty close to the final design. I got to give props to Ryan Murray. He did the model for this and he did a bang up job on it. Here's, looks like layer one adds a bunch more concept riffs. There's like this hooded face idea, like he's got a mushroom head. There's that alien from Star Wars that has all like the thick cheek ripples. Must have been riffing off of that guy. Layer 2's got an idea for what his console of the ship would be, what the bridge might look like, a bunch of screens and computers all hodgepodge together, kind of like my apartment, a townhouse. Another layer is a bunch of ship ideas. You see I'm riffing on this gold idea, maybe three vertical, three horizontal, ideas of how the drone might pop open and deploy weapons and thrusters, lights and lasers, doodads and whatnots. There's another paint over. It looks like I'm calling it a fanny pack, but must just be the idea that he is carrying these pockets with him. Thinking about Nerdy, Kid Vid. Here's another layer of refinement, adding the mouth and keyboard. Kind of brainstorming his crazy eyeball. See, this is starting to feel a little Earthworm Jimmy up here right now. And then these angled keyboards were all the rage in the early the late 90s, like 1997. I remember like the bent keyboards that were ergonomically more comfortable to work from. So here I would take the primary image and then copy it a whole bunch to do mouth shapes. We did have lip syncing. Animator Dan Beeson worked through figuring out the lip sync software and prototyping the phoneme animation system. So we have different mouth shapes for each letter. U and Y, F, M, P, B, C, and K. If you want to learn more about phonemes and animating, you can just books on this stuff. Animator Survival Guide is the main book people read for animating this kind of stuff. So I work very messy. And then here's some concepts for the ship. So start with a gray background. This is something I probably should have done earlier. Bryce Homick, who is one of our assistant concept artists on Ashes, he did most of the work for Ashes, the Singularity for Stardock and Oxide. He was big on XCOM 1. He was very important for that. We used him on Civ Unleashed, which was an unreleased Civ RTS game I worked on at Firaxis. So using just silhouettes, Piero McGowan, another great concept artist at Firaxis, and Aaron Yamada-Hampf, that whole crew of concept artists on the XCOM side of the building, big on the silhouette brainstorming direction. Let's start with black and white with just an eraser and a marker and build the silhouette out. And we were channeling for the spaceship the idea of a pinball. That's it. A pinball machine. Like, this is a fun ship. It's a happy ship. Make it more approachable. It's like the three balls in a pinball machine that you get when you put your quarter in. So the ship actually launched these drones out like pinballs. And that seemed relatable and ended up working and gave us some ideas for something. What ended up being a pretty unique ship. I'm not taking full responsibility for the design, but I did do a lot of the drawing and brainstorming for it. But the feedback from the team and the designer especially was crucial for this. I like having some constraints to work within. Like, I think that if you're given a complete sandbox, you can build anything with it, but it can be really unguided. I think constraints can lead you along a path that helps you find specificity. You need some context. And here's refinement. So this might be, 3 or 4 days of just brainstorming and refinement, bouncing between different projects, looking at inspiration, finding, maybe I go look at some photographs of a shipyard or some machinery, some military hardware, some NASA hardware, and get inspiration for what some of these details might look like. And eventually I ended up sculpting this thing and 3D modeling it and unwrapping it for the game. Here's some brainstorming for what the drone would look like. How does the drone open up? Well, it starts as a sphere, we know that, but how does it divide up and prepare itself to be a gun? It's a bunch of different concepts. I find that brainstorming in a sketch is about 3 times faster than brainstorming in 3D, but if you make something in 3D, then you can move the camera around it. So whereas you can get to one idea much faster in a drawing, but if you want multiple views of that idea, it takes longer to render each angle. Sculpting out of clay, you make a shape, you can look at it from all different angles. It's a different process for different people. Different strokes for different folks. So let's brainstorm something for you guys right now. First half of this talk was a lecture. Let's do a second half of some kind of demonstration, huh? Let's close all this down. Let's create a new document. 3,000 by 2,000. Is usually what I start with. Feel free to comment and say what up if you're watching this video, if you watch it later. I love seeing comments and stuff. Let me know what you think. I think my audio level is a little quiet. I apologize for that. This mic is cheap. If I kept doing this, I would invest in a better microphone down the road, but I think it's more important to record knowledge now while I'm motivated instead of waiting for some time in the future when the equipment's right. But I don't have the inspiration. I don't have the motivation to do it at the moment. So brainstorming, let's do a really quick spaceship maybe. Would that be fun? Maybe a car spaceship? I haven't drawn in a little bit, folks. It's been a few days, so bear with me. Let's draw a box just to warm up. It's pretty sloppy, pretty loose. I think my brush right now, my Wacom settings have this to be very heavy. Yeah, I got a soft tip. Let's go back to a medium firmness of that tip. Oh, in Photoshop, there we go. Let's draw a circle. So I have light drawing, heavy drawing. Okay, this should be pretty good for brainstorming. So if we're going to brainstorm, let's just silhouette saw it from the side. Maybe we have a cockpit, we have a body, wings, fin. It's looking like an F-16 jet right now. So we have our base F-16 silhouette. Let's do another one. Let's draw another idea. Maybe we have like an engine down here, maybe an engine up here. It's kind of weird. We're going to brainstorm a bunch of different shapes real fast. Intake up, maybe go YF-23 idea. Flying saucer thing, just for fun. I really like hypersonic glide body type shapes. Sometimes you can do like positive negative stuff where like this is a positive shape and then I could come in with an eraser and just erase some internal shapes and create some negative space. And I'm just making marks at first, and then I look at it and let my brain think, okay, what are those marks telling me exists? Are these different wing kind of surfaces? What is that? If this was drawn in a 3/4 view, what would that look like? So you could just use your chaotic mind to create lines and shapes that then lead to inspiration further down. I don't know, man. What if I wanted to channel a Jeep, something relatable? So there's a Jeep 3/4. Now, if I want to make a Jeep into a spaceship, is the engine going to be horizontal then? And we have the four wheels could be like four engines. We need this boxiness. Like, what are some iconic visual languages of a Jeep Wrangler? The headlights and the wheels are like the essential visual elements. We have like an X-wing engine Jeep thing going on. Let's keep riffing off of that Jeep ship. I kind of like the idea of that for today. Jeep ship. Let's keep going. Copy that image from here. Let's copy that. It kind of looks like a fish too, doesn't it? Feng Zhu talks about one of the best inspirations is deep sea creatures. Copy, paste. Hey, Drew, welcome to the show. I was hoping you'd figure out that I was on somehow. Thanks for tuning in on a Sunday with no warning. So I'm going to take a sketch, copy it over. Let's riff on it. We're jamming with drawings here. Let's get a different brush. I like this Sumi. I call it a Sumi brush. It's wider one direction, so it makes very thin lines going left to right and thicker lines going top to the bottom. What if we do like cow catcher style front end? Turbo scoop. Wing, wing. It's going like the Punisher a little bit. A little bit like aliens now. I'm going to use that Sumi brush for eraser also so we get some sharp eraser areas. It's feeling like a bruiser, feeling like a gangster kind of car. Let's try rounding it out. I'm having fun. Hope you guys are having fun out there. Brainstorm some flying car, Jeep things. Some kind of antenna thing, maybe. It's a little blue in the shadow parts. Just for fun. It's kind of cool looking. How are we feeling about it? Kind of neat. Kind of neat. Let's do another angle of that same idea of a ship. It's got these four kind of big vent surfaces and some highlight areas. Let's go 50%. A little highlight there, a little highlight there, a little highlight, 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 highlight. It's kind of cool. What's the silhouette? What's like the front profile look like? Real wide, kind of like a face. Feels a little generic. It's a little generic and boring. What can we do to make this more interesting? I'm going to fill it in. And then try to remove material from it. See if you can make the silhouette more interesting. This is starting to be more interesting. I think it kind of is. A little more military. Little aliens drop ship vibes to it. You have to get really good with the tools in order to fully let your subconsciousness flow through your meat tools, right? You got to get good at using them in order to narrow pathway, direct line of connection between the brainstem and your prefrontal cortex, neocortex ideas. That's why you got to practice. Got a couple likes out there. Thanks for the likes. John Mack likes the video. Luke, KT, thank you, friends. We'll do about 20 more minutes, and then we'll call it. I like doing the 1 hour. Doing the 1 hour talk. A lot easier than the 6 hour lecture at Micah. That's not true. It's a 5 hour class with a 1 hour break, and I would do an hour of demonstration in the first half. And then let the students work for another hour or two. And then give a second, maybe 30-minute demo in the second half of the class and let them practice that. And then answer questions and float around class, making sure students are getting it. And that was mostly for 3D stuff. So this is the process. Just loose brainstorming practice to refine. And then once you get an idea you kind of like, you noodle with that idea till you have something you kind of like. So I have a very curvy, a very angular version, a curvy version, and then some kind of Darth Vader-looking-y version. So let's do another one from the above three-quarter, but I'm kind of liking this idea of the future flying car thingamaboo. So let's do one from the three-quarter. So above three-quarter is going to start with a line. This is the axis of movement, so we have the Y, the X, the Z is going to be up. So car shape is front and is flat in the front, and then we have our forward engines. Rear engines are going to be up higher. Cockpit. Give me lights, some kind of intake. It's like a toenail. It kind of looks like I don't like this toe shape here. Let's redraw this. Intercooler, maybe? Maybe it's like cooled air intake. I don't know. So there's gonna be some perspective. So the distal engines are gonna be a little smaller than the proximal engines. Jeep's got some roll bars. No reason we can't put roll bars on our spaceship, right? It's like a durable, like all utility kind of hover plane ship thing. Maybe it's got suicide doors. Put suicides on the tour bus. Kind of X-wing looking hover ship dinghy. Landing gear back here, maybe. It's got some kind of bumper in the front. Can airplanes have bumpers? Kind of forward spoiler? Let's flip this horizontally because I feel like it's going to look really weird. I'm not seeing it quite right. Yeah, I'm not digging. The engines don't quite make sense. So we're just going to transform them a little bit. Get some perspective. That feels better. This is way too face shaped. It's kind of nose. Definitely eyes and a nose. I don't know if I like it though. Not eyes, nose, and teeth. I want it to be more Jeep-like, so could. It's kind of fun. I don't know what's inspiring this exactly. Maybe a CJ or an FJ Toyota, but it's a little different. This is feeling better. It's got to make the distal things a little bit smaller. The proximal things a little bigger. Let's add some wing tips to make this really feel like a flying machine. What do we think? It's looking crazy, right? Maybe pivoting, trim wings. Got a little F4U Corsair feel to it with those trim ailer, you know, floating aileron type things. Maybe a really clear strut kind of thing there. Maybe that's cool. Spaceship. What do we think? I want this to be a little bit more aerodynamic. So it looks like it's kind of like a, it looks like a flat bar instead of it having any kind of angle. Maybe I'll just do like a W. Yeah, it feels better. That's what's up. Needs better flight characteristics. Still got a bit of a face vibe to it, but that might be okay. Just to be a little different. It's so nose shaped. Maybe let's get rid of the nose. And make it more Porsche. More Porsche like. We like a shape. We want to echo that shape around as much as we can. Brainstorming spaceships, man. That's what we're up to. There's an angle out here. How's that feel? A little too anime. It's like cat ear wings. W tails are cool. Kind of has like a Batman vibe to it a little bit. Let's flip it again. And let's do a warp. Edit, transform, warp. This is legacy warp. Yeah, that feels better. Doesn't that feel better? Just like a little warping around, like pushing and pulling. So let's tighten this up and color it in a little bit. Let's clean up the outside. Let's make sure we just have a solid outside line. So that when we use our magic wand tool selection, we get just what we want. Make an art, ladies and gentlemen. So one magic wand tool on the outside, you have a good selection. We're going to select the invert of that. Control Shift I, and then we can fill in with some base color. Let's go with like a brownish yellow, maybe. That'd be fun. Oh, I'm seeing I don't have it selected quite right. Just fill that in with the hard round brush, fill in that area, and let's get rid of the internal area here. Cool. Lock the transparency, and then let's add some light and shadow. So shadows, let's go with the blue. That's good. What am I in? Eraser? Okay. Brush, blue, Tom brush. Shadow sign. Shadow. Hey, Drew, thanks for liking the space keep. Space sheep? Space sheep. Keep it deep. Let's get some highlight. A little warm sunny sun. Under the big bright yellow sun. Like a big bright yellow sun. Space Jeep. That's right. Drew says he likes a space Jeep. Thanks, Drew. Number one fan. Drew Hare, ladies and gentlemen. Not bad. Let's paint over all this to get the true highlights. Do I want the bars to be a different color? There's some red lights in the interior. Who knows? Purple gray wheels. Purple gray. So this is, ladies and gentlemen, how we brainstorm concepts by looking at the past, present, the future. And in the future, I'm looking forward to some pretty dope flying cars and maybe a greener, more gardened, beautiful urban landscape where we don't need as many roads because we're able to take off from these little helipads and we can fill in, like, imagine a world where half the pavement of the urban environment could just be gardens and vegetable plants and stuff. So let's, to finish off the theme of future cool stuff, let's maybe make some greenery on the in the world below. So let's take just a big brush and just kind of glaze in some green stuff. Maybe a river. A river runs through it. I don't know, man. And then there's a shadow. This thing's just taken off and just landed next to the side of a little river, and it's coming off the ground. I don't know what that looks like. We got a tree over here. Tree over there. Tree line, and then some dirt, maybe some dirt underneath. The grass is blowing. This thing's got some downforce. Dude's be spinning up the engines. Some kind of pink looking character getting on board the ship. Give him some, maybe some green pants, huh? And what kind of shirt? Blue shirt? You could solve a lot more of the problems in drawings, but I like to get to color. It gets me jazzed about the environment. Color tells me about the time of day. Tells me about if it's inside or outside. You know, the quality of the light. Cloudy day, rainy day, sunny day. That's what color does for you. Color has a lot to do with mood, right? Got some dust kicking up, maybe. Some high energy junk there, ladies and gentlemen. Tree stuff. Trees are real unhappy that there's a 200 mile per hour wind blowing around. Probably like New Orleans right now. Everyone say a prayer if you're into that for New Orleans, getting hit by a big old hurricane right now. Sounds like it's going to be as bad as Katrina. I haven't checked the news yet, but should have made landfall. you wanted to watch the news, you'd be watching the news. You came to watch the Tomcast. You came to watch Tom draw something weird. Here you go. Talked about some inspiration. Did a little doodling for you today. Something like that, ladies and gentlemen. Maybe I'll keep working on this. And if I do, I'm going to post it up online. It's nice to have some side projects, some creative stuff to do when I don't want to do real work, but I want to be productive. And this is fun. I have a fun time drawing for you guys. I know I am nowhere near the best artist out there. I think I might be the best artist inside of my own house, but that is because no one else is in the house with me right now. And that is all I can say. But sometimes that feels pretty good. If you feel bad about yourself, maybe you just need to shrink the size of your context down. If you're like, hey, maybe I'm not as beautiful as Claire Danes, you could say, well, maybe I'm as beautiful. I'm the most beautiful creature inside of the confines of my living room. Winning. Yeah, that's how it works, ladies and gentlemen. All right, we had fun. This was kind of cool. I hope this inspires you to make something better. And have a good day watching science fiction this fall. We're going to have a really good time watching Dune, Villanueva's Dune, when that comes out sometime in the future. Thanks for watching. That's all I got for now. Take care.